Good morning, everyone, and thank you all for having me here. This is a real pleasure to be among you this morning. We're going through very exciting times. The world is changing, and it's changing really fast these days, thanks to technology. And actually, we're just seeing a glimpse of what's happening today with artificial intelligence, because we're now entering another stage in this technological revolution, because we're making artificial intelligence a reality today. As Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella said, AI is the ultimate breakthrough. It will change every aspect of our lives. How we live, how we work, how we communicate, basically every single aspect of our life. It will help us solve the world's biggest problems, but the problem is, it won't be enough to ensure existing corporations' future. Because over the past few years, we made a huge breakthrough in artificial intelligence because we reversed our approach. Before, we used to program machines with rules to mimic human intelligence. We developed softwares that we fed with data that run according to the behaviors we define. That's the software you're currently using, you've been using over the past 10 years or so. But we understood that human intelligence does the exact opposite. You know that a baby does not need the rules of grammar to learn how to speak. He's just surrounded daily by people talking to him and implicitly understands the rules of grammar without even knowing they exist. And in fact, it's exactly what we do with all kinds of learning. We're exposed to the data and we try to abstract the rules to understand. And in fact, this is how we create artificial intelligence today. Instead of using programming rules to fit the data, we now do the opposite. We use the data to generate the rules. We discover the rules, we're training algorithms that use trial and errors and assumptions, just like a kid learning to walk. You probably heard of these algorithms. In fact, we talked about it before. For instance, we have deep learning. This is with deep learning that we can abstract complex concepts from the data just by generating examples and looking through those examples. This is with deep learning that, for instance, we can recognize people on pictures or cancer or medical images. We feed the algorithm with lots of pictures, lots of data, and we train it. We supervise it. We tell it who's on the pictures and on which picture there is cancer. And the more data we feed it with, the more the algorithm calibrates to perfectly recognize who's on the pictures and what's on those medical images. More recently, we used another technique that you probably haven't heard of because it's really getting popular these days. That's called reinforcement learning. And this is topping deep learning, actually. Google's going full reinforcement learning these days. In reinforcement learning, this time, we give the machine a visual environment with constraints and a goal to reach, and we'll let them try. We'll let them practice as many times as possible to reach this goal by themselves. And in this approach, when the algorithm gets closer to the goal, we reward it, we strengthen it. And when it moves away from the goal, we punish it. In fact, we prevent it from continuing this way. And it works amazingly well. This is what AlphaGo uses these days instead of deep learning. At the beginning, that's funny because we used reinforcement learning to teach the machines to play video games like Super Mario, and they sucked. I mean, they couldn't even move Mario. But the more they played, the more they calibrated, and after millions of trials and errors to play video games like Super Mario, they became excellent players. And the funny thing is, they played in a very weird way, because they actually found out a new and smarter way to play Super Mario. The same thing happened, as I was saying, with Google AlphaGo, DeepMind. Last year, they beat the best Go player in the world, because they fed their algorithm with the best games of the Go players in the world, and they train it against itself with the goal to beat itself. And again, he beat the Go master, the human Go master, very quickly because of this training. What happened here is also funny, because all the experts in the world couldn't understand how AlphaGo was playing Go. He played also in a very weird way. The thing is, again, he calibrated so much the algorithm that he discovered a new and smarter way to play Go. That surprised all the experts. And in fact, they're now digging into this new way of playing Go. The same thing happened with the Google car, you know, Google self-driving car. people are now afraid to go on the Google car because they calibrated their driving algorithm so much that it really surprises passengers when they go up into the Google car. But what's fascinating with reinforcement learning these days is that ever since we understood that we could manage to teach machine to recognize its visual environment and adapt its behavior to reach goals by itself, well, we understood that we could generalize this approach and use it to teach the machines to play and master any kind of task. It's like considering any task like a video game that the machine has to master, whether it's booking airline tickets online or helping science. So last year, in order to teach the machine's new task to master, an organization called OpenAI was launched by Elon Musk and some other very famous people in the US to teach the machine's new task to master. In fact, they launched a platform in which you'll soon be able to plug an AI to your softwares, any kind of software, whether it's your video games or your internet browser, your spreadsheet, etc., to show artificial intelligence new tasks to perform. The AI will watch your screen when, for instance, you're looking for information online, when you fill out a form, maybe when you shop, and then try to practice by itself to be able to complete that task all by itself. The goal is that the community, that is in fact all of us, teaches AI new tasks to perform. Very soon, no one will program machines as we do today with complex code that requires deep knowledge. In fact, we'll all be training artificial intelligence. We'll all be contributing to teaching knowledge to artificial intelligence and master new tasks. In fact, programmers today are laying the foundation so that we can all teach machines to practice and make any kind of task in virtual environments with very simple indications. And to go further, another tool that will give AI and machines in general, in addition to vision, so that they can master more and more concepts and understand the world, is language. You know that most available knowledge today, whether it's in books, it's online, it's in your conversations in social network, this is written, this is text. Well, in fact, we're now teaching machines to master human language. This is just the beginning. We have lots of progress to make, but we're making machines more and more understand text and talk by themselves. And in fact, this is a very important step in creating AI, because once AI masters human language, not only you'll have better and smoother and more natural interactions with machines, for instance, you won't use Google anymore with keywords in the search bar. You'll just handle the conversation with Google, a natural conversation. It will understand the questions, look for the answers online, and then respond to you as if it was your friend. And also, AI will be the knowledge you'll feed it with and make new discoveries by itself. Maybe someday it will be able to process all the available knowledge and then make new discoveries all by itself. In fact, as was said before, AI is already surpassing us humans in many, many fields. And again, this is just the beginning. In health, it reads and understands, this is Watson, thousands and thousands of scientific research on cancer and finds new effective molecules within a few weeks. It makes diagnosis on rare cancers within a few minutes where doctors can't. Again, this is just the beginning. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg said that last summer, that with AI, we have the potential to cure all the diseases by the end of the century. You know that Google wants to go even further, and they consider death as a disease, and they want to cure it. They want to make us live forever. Every day, we have news coverage of the latest advances in AI. Every car manufacturer said that pretty soon every vehicle will be driven all by itself with AI. Even Uber is considering it today. We have law firms in New York that use AI to master the exact same jobs as lawyer. It does it better and faster. Google announced that it cut 40% down its cooling bill on its server's cooling with an AI that adjusts the parameters in terms of how to master energy in the servers. Every industry is now either being disrupted are augmented by artificial intelligence. And in addition to the logical and rational dimension of intelligence that allows us to do all that by optimizing algorithms, we're now dealing with another dimension of intelligence. I'm talking about creativity, irrational invention. Because we now use these algorithms and allow them to spread hypothesis, to stress hypothesis in the data, to try and connect what has never been connected before, to try and explore the data, and then to create. This is how we use AI today, for instance, to write entire novels, movie scripts. This is how we use AI today also. Google uses AI to write music and make paintings. And this is also thanks to these algorithms that last year, two artificial intelligences developed their own encryption algorithm to communicate with each other. The problem is, humans were not able to crack what they were saying to each other. We had no idea what they were saying to each other. The challenge for the coming years will be to make AI more human, both in the way it works and also in the way it interacts with us. To continue to optimize its logical and rational capabilities, and also to enhance its irrational abilities, its creativity. And finally, this is the biggest challenge that we have in AI, to make it more flexible, more adaptable, autonomous, and give AI common sense. This is the biggest challenge in AI research today, to give AI common sense. You know that at DeepMind, the AI company that was acquired by Google 3 years ago, they said, the CEO said, that their main goal was to solve intelligence to then use it for everything else. We actually feel, we see that this revolution has started, but it seems that it won't impact our daily lives until at least 10 or 20 years or even more, that this is science fiction. This is already a reality. This is not in 10 or 20 years. We're already experiencing AI every day. Internet giants are now all infusing artificial intelligence in all their products and services. This is how Google allows you today to prepare the responses to your emails on behalf of you. This is why it allows you to find your photos based on what's on the photos. This is also how Snapchat today uses artificial intelligence to enhance advertisement targeting. Facebook uses it to filter fake news. Instagram to show you the best pictures that you're likely to like. Another funny fact. Do you know Tinder, the dating app? Well, the CEO recently made a statement and he said that pretty soon AI will be able to find the perfect partner for you based on AI with all the right indicators, even if you don't understand why this is a right partner. Every industry is either being augmented or totally disrupted by AI today. And in fact, it already seems and feels normal to us. It already seems normal because our brains perfectly adapt to our current environment. And in fact, it adapts so well that it makes us blind in terms of how fast this is going. We don't understand how these technologies impact the world once they just get into the stage. We remember Clifford Stoll. You know Clifford Stoll? He wrote an article in 95 in Newsweek where he said, a very famous article, where he said that the internet was going to disappear in 96, that the internet was slow and personal, and that we would never be able to use the internet on the go. Well, now Clifford Stoll is hiding himself. He's really ashamed of this article. It totally changed his life. We're currently living this kind of moment today with artificial intelligence. On one side, we have more and more amazing results with artificial intelligence in every field. And on the other, more and more experts, journalists, philosophers, even consultants saying that the machines will never be able to do this or that, to have creativity, have emotions, replace humans, etc. In fact, every time a new technology comes out, we feel it's already, everything it has to offer is already here. We don't see its potential and how fast this is going. We thought that we could never go up into the moon. We thought that we could never build high-speed trains. We also thought that we could never sequence or not even modify human genome. all of this is a reality today. This is no more science fiction. In fact, our brain is biased. It works in a linear way. We tend to think that what's going to happen in the next 2 years will happen at the same speed as the two previous years. Our brain is biased. What's happening today is exponential, but our brain works in a linear way. It requires tremendous imagination to figure out what the future will look like 2 years from now because of this exponential acceleration. Where in fact, we're now experiencing with AI what happened to electricity at the beginning of the 20th century. It will very soon be a commodity available everywhere to anyone at a cost that's standing to zero. So what will it look like? Well, first, AI will enter our daily lives as intelligent assistants. You know them all so far. It's Amazon's Alexa that you put in your living room that you can talk to. It's a Google Assistant that you can hold a conversation with. Well, so far, they're kind of stupid. In fact, they barely use artificial intelligence. They're just programmed to just recognize your voice and then do a simple task correlated to it. But thanks to the algorithms I mentioned before, remember, deep learning and reinforcement learning, they'll improve. In fact, also with the training that we'll all have them do, they'll improve and soon be able to perform any kind of task in every aspect of our life. In fact, the next step is that we'll all be endowed with an intelligent assistant like this that will replace our smartphones. They will do everything on behalf of us. They'll do our groceries, handle our schedules, they'll help our children learn, and also they'll be our personal experts in everything. They'll be our bankers, our lawyers, our doctors, our advisors, even some they may be our friends. All of this in one single assistant so that they will free our schedule. They will enhance our interactions, our global interactions with the rest of the world, and also facilitate our access to knowledge. These assistants will become our digital butlers, a perfect copy of us in the digital world that will represent us in every interaction with the rest of the world, with our friends, and with other artificial intelligences in the rest of the world. This is where AI is heading toward these days. But the problem is, AI is going crazy these days. Corporations keep hearing about AI every day in the news. Consultants keep pretending that AI will solve corporations' biggest problems, that it will help us reduce their costs, streamline their processes, and change their lives. The problem is, the reality is, that this is totally wrong. Artificial intelligence will not be a game changer for corporations, as opposed to what consultants are saying, for two reasons. First, artificial intelligence is spreading very fast, but it might make some part of the businesses of corporations totally obsolete. Suppose you're a car manufacturer, and you want to use AI, and you're looking for use cases in AI. You listen to consultants, and you decide it's a good idea to use artificial intelligence to automatically adjust seatbelt tightness according to speed. So to provide a better customer experience during an accident, for instance. You decide it's a good idea. The problem is, to train in AI today is to make seatbelts disappear. We want to have self-driving vehicles with no seatbelts. What's the point of using AI in seatbelts? So first, some businesses might become obsolete. So don't look for the use cases in artificial intelligence. First, think about the strategy where you're going to. Make sure your business, the business you're handling, will still exist in the future. And if so, what they will look like. So then you can use use cases in your future business. Some businesses will become obsolete. And the second reason why AI won't be a game changer is because, again, AI is a totally crazy thing today. Everyone wants to go in AI. Every corporation is now infusing AI in all its businesses, processes, etc. So when you use AI in all your products, your services, your processes, the way you interact with your clients, what do you think your competitors will do? Of course they'll replicate. They also use the same processes with AI in everything that they do. AI won't be a game changer, because once you have AI in everything that you do in your business, your competitors will do the same. You will have to thrive to innovate and design a new strategy to know where the value is. If you don't use AI, you will die. This is mandatory, but it won't save you. So you'll understand that we're going through very exciting times today, from a technology that was first coming out from the computer labs, mainly in the US and now in China. This is not true in Europe, as opposed to what everybody's saying. Artificial intelligence is now entering the scene as a global political question. This is as big as nuclear weapons and genetic engineering. But what's fascinating with artificial intelligence today is that ultimately, this is on the nature of our own intelligence that it sheds some light. Because you've all seen that so far, I have talked a lot about artificial intelligence and the breakthroughs we're making these days, but I haven't defined what intelligence was. This is because we have plenty of theories and approaches to define it, and scientists do not agree on that. This is science. This is really normal. But artificial intelligence helps us understand what intelligence is. The more we understand the brain, the human brain, intelligence, the more ideas we get to develop artificial intelligence. And on the reverse, the more we develop artificial intelligence with the algorithms I mentioned, the more we understand, we refine our own understanding of our own intelligence. So thank you all for listening. If you have questions, I'll be around. Thank you all for attending.
Thank you very much for, my name is Charles Gutman, I'm from Boston.
You're from Harvard.
Yes. Very nice talk and very fascinating and engaging. What about the anxiety that people like me could feel vis-a-vis artificial intelligence? The question, the philosophical question about, am I still relevant?
You're absolutely right. In fact, when I give these talks, I have about 10 to 15 minutes to raise the ethical concerns, the legal concerns, the moral questions that it raises, because this is really important. We're going to have to create an ethics committee, a global ethics committee, to tackle these issues. They're absolutely fundamental. What I haven't said is that these algorithms are providing more and more results in every field, but we don't understand how they work. Imagine a huge spreadsheet with lots of values, millions and millions of value, and when you trick the algorithm, it changes a few of them. How can you understand that? This is a real challenge in artificial intelligence these days. And if you don't understand how the algorithm works, you're not likely to use it. Would you hop into a Google car if you don't understand the algorithm, knowing that? This is a big, big issue. Other kinds of anxiety, are you referring to jobs? Automation? Okay. There's a big, big, big debate on job automation, job replacement today. What's fascinating is that if you listen to internet giants, they're all saying that jobs are not going to disappear. That we're going to kill some jobs and create new jobs that we don't even know exist. But I think they're not honest when they say that. The goal of artificial intelligence is to be able to do everything that our brain does. We're not there yet. Again, this is a big challenge. We have a lot of progresses to make, but this is the main goal. What makes us different humans at work? This is our intelligence. So once we have a powerful enough artificial intelligence, again, this is not the case yet, but this is the goal, this will destroy every kind of job. We're going to need a new society that's more adapted to this revolution. You've heard of basic income. If you listen to people like Bill Gates or Elon Musk, they're all up for basic income. But when you listen to corporations, this is not what they say. Publicly, they say jobs won't disappear. But if you talk to them in private, off the record, they all say jobs will disappear. But they can't say it. They have corporate communication that prevent them from saying this. So to make you feel more comfortable, we need ethical committees. They have to be global, on a global level, otherwise it won't be useful. And third, yes, this is a transition toward a new society.